Good morning. My name is Joshua Hatton. I am a member of the Texas State Employees Union, Local 6186. I'm going to take the next 10 minutes or so to introduce our panel and to provide you with some background information that will help you to get as much as possible out of the presentations by our two speakers. As you probably have noticed over the past week or so, the issue of immigration control has become big news. The question of how people who have come or are coming from other countries to the United States should be treated is now at the center of American political debate. The Trump regime's answer is clear. Immigrants should be disrespected, abused, and exploited. But it's clear that not everybody agrees with this approach. Elected officials, religious leaders, and schools all over the country have publicly stated that they will provide sanctuary to immigrants. And thousands of people went to airports last weekend, including here at DFW, to help free people who had been held prisoner by Trump's order to his migration police. Today, our panel will discuss two approaches that oppose, to different degrees, Trump's attack on immigrants. One approach that agrees with some of Trump's policies is called immigration reform. The other one, which is in total opposition to Trump's approach, can be called abolition. Over the last few years, a large number of politicians from a wide section of the political spectrum have been telling us that we need to fix our broken immigration system. When we see Nikki Haley, Trump's ambassador to the United Nations, former President Obama, and Senator and Democratic Socialist Bernie Sanders all making this same statement, we might be inclined to see it as being reasonable, because it is a view shared by both Republicans and Democrats. However, if we want to think for ourselves, then we should be especially skeptical of and think through carefully any policy that is promoted by such a wide range of actors. As history shows us, sometimes things that just seem to be a matter of common sense can actually have terrible consequences for a lot of people. For politicians like Haley, Obama, and Sanders, the way that we should fix our supposedly broken immigration system is through something that they call immigration reform. To reform something is, by definition, to keep its core while making some changes. Immigration reformers want us to keep the core of continuing to approve and deny visa applicants, such as for study and work, and to deport unauthorized residents. The changes that they suggest are to increase efforts to stop unauthorized entry, what they call illegal immigration, and to create a pathway to legal status for unauthorized residents. Now, in contrast to this reformist, seemingly common sense approach, stands one that you have probably never heard of before, and that you might find unsettling at first. But this alternative approach to immigration control is one that I hope that I will be able to convince you to join me in promoting. It's called abolitionism, where the idea is not just to change something or to reform it, but rather to get rid of it entirely. The term abolitionism comes to us from the anti-slavery campaigns of the 19th century. The abolitionists believed that slavery couldn't be reformed or made acceptable. It needed to be done away with or abolished. They thought that equal rights should be granted to all people, regardless of what race they were said to have. Now, turning back to the present, you've heard of the saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? Well, today's abolitionists, in the tradition of their anti-slavery ancestors, say that our immigration system ain't broke. Don't fix it, abolish it. The immigration system ain't broke because it does exactly what it's designed to do, and that is to discriminate against a person on the basis of that person's citizenship. People are denied visas, imprisoned, and deported because they are said to belong to a particular country and have its citizenship, like Chinese, British, Dutch, or Australian. Like the system of slavery and its discrimination on the basis of race, this kind of discrimination can't be fixed or made acceptable. We must abolish it and do away with it entirely, while ensuring that people have equal rights, regardless of what citizenship they might be said to have. What exactly is discrimination on the basis of citizenship, and why is it unacceptable from this perspective? To discriminate is, by definition, to treat a person differently from everybody else. Slavery was discrimination on the basis of a person's race. People who were said to be African or black were denied equal rights. And how, in the minds of people during the time of slavery, did a person become African or black? Simply by being born. According to the thinking at that time, a child who was born to a parent who was said to be black was also black, and therefore able to be discriminated against. The baby's actions had nothing to do with it, right? We, of course, have no control over the people to whom we are born, nor over the location, the time of day, the date, or the season. Where, when, and to whom we are born is purely a matter of chance. Discrimination on the basis of citizenship is wrong because citizenship, like race, is an identity that is assigned to us by society at birth purely by chance. It's based on where or to whom we are born. Although we are taught that race and citizenship are real, they have no independent reality. They are just categories that are dreamed up by human beings and forced onto us as accidents of birth. Therefore, if it's wrong to discriminate on the basis of something made up that's called race because it's an accident of birth, then it's just as wrong to do so on the basis of something else made up that's called citizenship. For today's abolitionists, then, the fix that is proposed by immigration reformers is morally unacceptable because it includes detention, deportation, and the denial of both entry and equal rights to migrants, which are practices that discriminate on the basis of citizenship, something that is only an accident of birth. Our belief, which we share with our abolitionist ancestors who fought against slavery, is that the only acceptable option is equal rights for all. Now, once we have decided to become abolitionists, then what is our next step? How do we go about abolishing discrimination on the basis of citizenship? The task seems even greater now that there is a president of the United States who is following through on his threats to intensify this form of discrimination by denying visas to Muslims, building a wall along the US-Mexico border, and deporting all unauthorized residents of the United States. And here in the state of Texas, we have Governor Abbott, Lieutenant Governor Patrick, and a legislature that passed a law in 2015 that would have made it a felony to conceal, harbor, or shield an undocumented person. Although it might appear to us now that all hope is lost, again, the 19th century abolitionists can show us a way forward. In 1850, abolitionists faced a similar, seemingly hopeless situation. The fugitive slave law, which facilitated the kidnapping and return of people who had escaped from slavery to their so-called owners, and, like Governor Abbott's law, made it illegal for a person to help an escapee to avoid capture, was a significant setback for the abolitionists. But they did not react by scaling down their efforts or by changing their message. Rather, they defied the law by helping people to evade the authorities via the Underground Railroad and by freeing people who had been detained. They continued to demand equal rights and an end to discrimination. And most importantly, they intensified their organizing efforts. They gave lectures, held rallies, circulated literature, and formed associations. As a result, they succeeded in convincing moderate reformers to become revolutionary abolitionists. We modern abolitionists can do the same. Who then are today's moderate reformers whom we can recruit to abolitionism through effective organizing? Who are the people who are at the forefront of the immigrant rights movement? It's people who identify as Latinos or Hispanics and African Americans or blacks. Survey research consistently finds that Hispanics and African Americans are more in favor of immigration reform than are people identified as whites, and that Hispanics are even more pro-immigration reform than are African Americans. For example, an October 2015 Pew Research Center survey asked people for their opinions regarding a key piece of the reformist agenda, whether undocumented immigrants living in the U.S. who meet certain requirements should or should not be allowed to stay legally. The percentages of people who answered that they should indeed be allowed to stay legally varied by ethnicity. The highest percentage were people who identified as Hispanic at 87%. Next were those who identified as Black at 83%. The lowest were people who identified as white at 68%. We abolitionists should focus our organizing efforts then on African Americans and Hispanics, two communities who are already very sympathetic to our cause. Now, just how we should organize these particular groups who are already down with the movimiento is the topic that my compañeros with me here on stage will address in their presentations. First, Roberto Corona, a human rights advocate and educator with Pueblo sin Fronteras, or People Without Borders, will talk about his experiences with Latinos. And then Brianna Brown, the deputy director of Texas Organizing Project, will do the same about her experiences with African Americans. Both Roberto and Brianna will discuss each group's views on citizenship discrimination, the efforts that have been made to move them towards abolitionism, and the effects of these efforts, and finally, creative ideas for doing so more effectively. Now, although the election of President Trump and his attacks on immigrants might make it appear that our goal is out of reach, our abolitionist ancestors have shown us that we can and must bring an end to discrimination on the basis of citizenship. We look forward to discussing how we can best do this with you, especially with the high school student members of the audience, at the end of our presentations and again during the roundtable this afternoon. Roberto.
I'm gonna stand up because I'm a little sleepy. And I hope you don't sleep too. I'm an immigrant. I was born in Michoacán, Mexico. Michoacán. And but before being an immigrant, I'm a human being, right? And it's a human right to migrate, to move from one place to another. Many of you are migrants or immigrants. Immigrant is somebody that comes, right? I'm not an immigrant like the Europeans that Abby was talking about. But I'm an immigrant because I came here. And a migrant is the one that is on the move, right? That is moving. Many of you maybe were not born here. You were born in Dallas and you immigrate to Arlington, you see? Or I've been immigrating inside the country. I've been living in so many places. So I'm an immigrant, and I've been a migrant. I'm on the move. Like many of our ancestors moved to one place to another in the search for food, for water, to better live, no? My family came to the United States for a better life. And for some of my brothers, it was not very a better life, because some of my brothers are engineers in Mexico, and they have a career, and they end up working on something else. So I want to talk about my story. So to put the human face on migration, my ancestors, part of my mama, are Purépechas, an indigenous group in Michoacán. Some of their ancestors come from the south of Spain, a little Moros, like Middle Eastern, that moved to Africa. So I have brothers that they have no hair and a lot of beard. And sometimes they think, you're from Middle East? No, I'm Mexican. Yeah? And part of my ancestors from behalf of my mom were black. My mom is very curly. And everybody, we all come from Africa, right? Mama, our motherland, is in Africa. So we've been moving around. So part of my ancestors, which I'm very attached to my mama. I have learned from my mom more than I have learned from books. My mama is very attached to the earth and is part of our identity. We are trees, that's how we think. We are trees. Now imagine you are a tree, just like following our tradition, my tradition. I'm a tree. And imagine you are a tree, you're growing deep roots. And then you're growing up, and you feel the wind. But all of a sudden, it comes an axe, or a sword in this case, because the Spanish, in my area, they had a sword when they come to conquer my people. And they cut the tree, the branches, and the trunk. But maybe some of you have heard this, they forgot the root. So this root is still growing and flourishing in many places in all the Americas. And America, that's not the real name of America. You know what Americo Vespucio, no? They call it America because of this guy. But they have many names. Turtle Island, many names, indigenous native names. And then they came together, and they now it's called Aviala, which is it's a continent of nature, of life, no? So we live in Aviala. So later, that root start resisting all kinds of environments and brutality. And then other plants came from other places. They were forced to come, like the African people. Some others started coming from other places. And we forming, and they attaching to this root, and a new tree is coming up. But there's people that is resisting this nature, this what is happening. You see? You follow the story. And these people who is resisting, like Mr. Trompas, yeah, and some of the people, they cannot accept this reality. So they're resisting. But we are resisting for 500 years, more than that. We've been resisting so many presidents and so many other people that comes, and we're still alive. We're still very much, and we have a lot of energy. And the people that I work with, I work mainly with migrants, with jornaleros standing on the corners looking for a job. We have in Pueblo Sin Fronteras, we are a collective, and in Mexico we have 3 shelters. We are about to open another one, and we try to help migrants on the move, are coming mainly from Central America, right? I'll talk about this because in order to abolish this nonsense, we have to recognize that first is our right, inalienable right, that we have the right to move to anywhere. Who put the borders? For what reason? As my compañero was saying, it's to control labor. Money can go, come and go, right? You can send a check to everywhere. You have a visa? You have your papers? They don't ask for any papers to money. So capital can be moved, but not people. Oh, depends. If we need the labor, open the borders. Put a Statue of Liberty. Welcome everybody. Hey, venganse. And work. Most of those workers build all these huge buildings now in the East Coast. The Bracero program. My papa came as a Bracero. So when he came, I have a friend that her name is Rosa Marta Zarate, and they're still fighting to get the money that the Mexican government stole from the Bracero program. You see? because they didn't. When they were working here, they used to get some money, no, out for savings or whatever, and they never gave that money back. So they're still in the fight. They're 75, 80 years old, the braceros, and they still asking in the struggle to get the money back. So my dad came, and then when he saw how the treatment, he went back to Mexico right away. His idea was to come to buy the horses that he liked and the guns, because in the place where my dad grew up is like those Mexicans from the movies. The big sombrero, charros, pistola, and caballo. So that was his idea. No, I want to go. But when he saw that, this is inhumane. I'm going back to my tierra and live over there and plant my frijol and my maíz. No? So how is it that people like my dad decided to stay there and many others? No? It's a resistance. Is looking for ways not to depend on all these, what is happening around, so we can be autonomous. And that's another way my dad started working with the Zapatistas. My dad went only to third grade of school. He barely knew how to read and write, but he knew the Mexican Constitution. He knew the agrarian law by heart. He memorized books, entire books. He was incredible. He just learned how to read, but he learned about his people. He learned about the struggle, and he said, I'm going to stay here. I'm going to fight. I'm going to see. So this struggle not to recognize borders, because these limits limit us to come together. As soon as we put a line, or you stay in that side, I stay in this side, you will not be able to make any friends. We need to turn down those borders. And because of the mentality of certain people is better than other, or certain color is better than other. So this abolitionist point of view is becoming more human. It's not right. Is slavery right? No. Why do we have to put restrictions in human mobility? It has to do with power and money. What are we doing in community bases and small groups? Is we're trying to find a way not to depend on these monstrous capitalism that is destroying our land. This is more important than water now. You see? When there's no more water, what are we going to drink? When there's no more cucumbers or apples, now everything is fake, right? For us, for our people, the most important thing is Mother Earth. And all these struggle that is going on around is, it's about fighting about who controls the earth and the resources of Mother Earth. Everything that is going on in the Middle East, it's just a fight on who's going to control that area. So, from our point of view, it's become and come to our senses as human beings and get rid of any law, anything that restricts us and put barriers on boundaries and becoming more humane. I like to, there's somebody, see, there's a Spanish poet that says, caminante, no hay camino, se hace camino al andar. Basically, we make the road as we walk. So we migrants always walk and look for new ways to get there. So if there's a big wall, we're going to find a way to jump it. That's not a problem. There's no borders for us. No borders. I'd like to finish with this quote from Mechnik, is a Polish, of Polish solidarity. He says, start doing the things you should be done. Start being what you think society should become. Start. Do you believe in free speech? Then speak freely. Do you love the truth? Then tell it. Do you believe in an open society? Then act in the open. Do you believe in a decent and humane society? Then behave decently and humanely. Thank you.
Good morning. Let's start that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are y'all doing?
Good.
I have to tell you, the lights are kind of bright up here. I'm really excited to be here today. I'm going to do a little bit of an introduction through my speech so y'all can get to know me a little bit. I hope that's all right. But I wanted to start out with just a quick little poll. Does anyone in here listen to Dead Prez?
Yes.
Anybody? No? Golly. Okay, so we're going to do a little education too. So when I was preparing to come and speak today, part of that preparation had to do with listening to some music, right? And one of my favorite rap duos, I just can't believe people don't know, Dead Prez. They're often called hip hop with a gangsta lean, right? And there's one passage that I was kind of like meditating on. So I'm gonna say it now, but I wanna get y'all to say it back at another time so we can get kind of some energy in here, right? So they asked this question, y'all ready for it? Do you want Alexis or justice? A dream or some substance? A beamer, a necklace, or freedom? So do you want Alexis or justice? A dream or some substance? A beamer, a necklace, or freedom? So I'm gonna come back to Dead Prez. I'm gonna channel them a little bit later. And I'm hoping y'all can connect, right? Because this question of citizenship to me is all about freedom and our pursuit for freedom. And I must also say that this format is a little unnatural for me because I'm an organizer. And organizers believe in stimulating questions, right? I'm really really interested in what answers could be. So if you're at all feeling like you have an answer to a question that I might be asking, I want to invite you all to answer it while I'm up here, right? That'll help me in these bright lights. So I'm going to introduce myself a little bit more. I'm Brianna Brown. I'm the Deputy Director of the Texas Organizing Project. I'm an organizer at heart. I'm the daughter of a sharecropper who used to work, as he said, from can to cane, right? Unlike Roberto here channeling my ancestors. I'm also the descendants of slaves. So this question of freedom, of my freedom, of the freedom of my people, is essential core to the work that motivates me every day to do the things that I do. And just in my lineage, we've experienced varying degrees of freedom and also citizenship. And whenever I talk about citizenship, right, similar to conversations that we've been sparking here, it's not bound to boundaries, right? Citizenship is something inalienable. My great-great-great-grandmother and grandfather on my dad's side, they were slaves and knew nothing of the citizenship that I speak of. Her great-grandson, my grandfather, made considerations about how many children they were gonna have to be able to work the land that they leased in order to make a living as sharecroppers. And he was a proud Republican voter, not a Trump voter, right? This was before the Republican Party was what it is today. And my dad's family participated in the biggest migration there was ever in the United States of America, which is black folks moving from the South to the North. Why did they move? That's not rhetorical. Why do you move? Why did black folks go from the South, right? From first slavery, then sharecropping, to Jim and Jane Crow, to the North. What were they looking for? Opportunity, right? What kind of opportunity? Jobs. I can't, what? Factory work. Factory work, work, right? An essential part of that, too, is they were looking for dignity, right? So today, I stand here pretty firm in my idea of citizenship, but I also know that it's a pretty fluid thing, right? And that it's under attack today. The current person who's up to be our next Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, you know, he famously once said that, you know, he thought the KKK was a good thing. They were okay. You know, this terrorist organization that was largely responsible for trying to stomp out any sense of citizenship my family has, that they were okay. That was until he, of course, found out they smoked marijuana, and that made them not okay, right? So my role, my job as an organizer, and does that mean anything to anybody in the room when I talk about being an organizer? Anybody know any organizers? Who's an organizer? Your mom, yes. We got all kinds of everyday heroes and heroines. People like Dolores Huerta and Cesar Chavez, right? Dr. Martin Luther King, Ella Baker, names that you never hear, like this young woman's mom, right? So organizer's role is all about helping people connect the dots, right? If you need a stop sign in your neighborhood, if you live in a state that didn't expand their Medicaid because of politics and it denies you and your family the opportunity to go to the doctor, if you want the ability to go into your child's school without the threat of being taken out in handcuffs because you don't have papers, if you want the ability to realize your freedom, your citizenship that's being denied to you at the ballot box, that's what I do every day as an organizer, right? I fight these fights, and these fights are very much wrapped into the fight of racial justice, of economic justice. And if we win, it's in the pursuit of freedom. So I like to think about the work that I do every day as being a part of the freedom movement. And just as the abolitionist of yesteryear, who I'm standing up here on their shoulders, organizing is fundamental to that. And organizing is all about pulling people together, right? Because there's so many efforts now to pull us apart. And I'd like to just highlight three things that I think lessons we can learn from our abolitionist brothers and sisters that could help us in this moment, right? I think we have to start high with the big idea. And the big idea that we're discussing here in this panel is the idea of abolishing citizenship-based discrimination. Whenever I say that, like the ability to, like, we need to start high, what does that mean to people, right? Whenever you are, do I have any gamblers in the room? I hope not. Well, you gotta start high, because otherwise what happens, you start negotiating from an already compromised position, right? We ended up with an Affordable Care Act that doesn't have a public option in it, and that was because we started the conversation from already compromised positions. So we have to start big. And our abolitionist brothers and sisters, they started big. They said, no, no more slavery. End racial segregation, right? And that is what this moment calls for. This moment calls for us not to shrink, but to be big and bold in our demands. Also, the abolitionist movement was a diverse coalition, right? It was a coalition of progressive white folks. You had Thomas Paine and the Grimke sisters. And it was also woman-led. Where are my women? Yeah. Right? I don't know about you. I don't know if people have taken to the streets in the last month or so. I don't know how many times, like, I brought some of my science with me because that's the thing that's really motivating me now. But these fights, these movements are being led by women, right? And so was the abolitionist movement. We had people like Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth and Maria Stewart who were central to driving this big idea, which was to end slavery, right? Okay, so we had to start high. We have to have a big idea and not shrink in it, right? We have to own that demand. We have to build a diverse coalition, right? And that coalition needs to be women-led, women at the front. And then the third thing that our abolitionist brothers and sisters did is that they appealed to something higher than laws that are written in statutes, you know, in Congress. They appealed to a moral high ground, right? So it wasn't about slavery being wrong because someone had said that it was right in a law that they had written, right? It was wrong because it was essentially wrong to our values. Okay, so let's say there's going to be a little, I told you also there's going to be a quiz in this. So there's three things. So the first thing we got to do in this moment to realize things is what? Start high, right? Got to start high. Number two, what do we have to do? Have a diverse coalition that's woman-led. Yeah? Okay. And then two, we have to connect universal values to the fight. You know, oftentimes as an organizer, there's a tool that we have literally in our toolbox that's called, you know, the wrap, right? It's how we connect with people. Because organizing is not just an art, it's very much a science, right? So we know that we can connect with people if we use a certain structure to how we talk, right? And the part of the rap that I love so much is the vision part, where we talk about not all the things that are wrong, but it's like, what do you want? And what do you believe in? And you help pull out their values, right? Because it's not enough to talk about wanting justice. It's not enough to talk about wanting equity and inclusion. You have to figure out a way to animate that, right? To take that value off the wall and put it into action, which is what we've seen, right? Have people been in the streets in the last, like, or been at the airport? Has anyone been to any of these protests in the last month, right? People are taking their values off of the shelf and putting them into action. This is what this moment is calling for. So, okay, so we do all these things. Like, those are just like three things, right? And there's a whole lot of more, lot of things that we could do. Are there any guarantees? Will any of that guarantee anything? No. And I'm certainly not here to say that it will. I'm certainly not here to say that it will guarantee us the end of discrimination based on citizenship. But I know that the fight will continue, and the fight is so essential, right? And I know another essential part of that fight is really making a sacrifice. Does anyone know how long the Montgomery bus boycott was? It was 386 days. 386 days people did not take public transportation. Black folks were not taking public transportation, right? To win. So we absolutely need stamina and we need sacrifice. And again, I'm gonna return to those Dead Prez lyrics because I think that they encapsulate that idea that there are no guarantees and it's gonna take sacrifice, right? So do people remember if the question I asked, do you want a Lexus?
Or justice.
Do you want a Lexus?
Or justice.
Do you want a dream?
Or
do you want a dream? Do you want a beamer, a necklace, or?
Freedom.
A beamer, a necklace, or?
Freedom.
A beamer, a necklace, or?
Freedom.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Roberto and Brianna. We're joined by Robert. Robert, what do you have for us?
There's not going to be a break.
Right, so we're going to, right at the end of this question and answer session, I'm told that we're just going to move right along with our next session, all right? Here we go.
Okay, so thanks for your many good questions. Unfortunately, we only have time for a couple of them now. The rest will be forwarded to the roundtable this afternoon. The first question is, what advice do you have to those still searching to find their voice for social justice and advocacy?
Yeah, I'd love to. Who's still searching? And that's not like a rhetorical question, because it's like, I'm like, oh, come see me, right? There's so many things. There's such a menu of things that you can be doing, right? And I think that the age, what I didn't talk about from our abolitionist brothers and sisters was there's so many ways to engage these days in the movement. You can create your own movement with your thumbs, which is kind of amazing. Don't let the kind of, I mean, it can be like this intimidating thing, right? This idea like that you're gonna take your values, you're gonna put them into action somehow. But there are so many ways, there's so many outlets, and I mean, I'm happy to like talk with anybody about how you can get involved with the Texas Organizing Project, or you know, how you can like, you know, do some things just, you know, really independently. I do think a real key though, right? Fundamental to organizing is that our power is in numbers, so that what you do is done in connection with other people, right? Because that's gonna be what eventually wins. So
a lot of people asked about the question of power and the question of what reforms are acceptable. So I've combined it into a question. How is it possible to build power for needed reforms, let alone abolitionism, and barring abolitionism, what are acceptable reforms?
I can start and then you, okay. I think that fundamental is also what Brianna was saying. We have to talk about it. We have to create the space for dialogue. Dialogue is very important. So we have to create the spaces like this one, and then small groups, and start talking about it. And start talking about solutions that may happen. Maybe you have it right there, no? So I think we need to start with dialogue.
Yeah, I think if the question is what kinds of reforms are acceptable, from the perspective I'm coming at it from, and I think if you have an equal rights perspective, then no reforms are acceptable, right? We keep pushing and pushing and pushing until we get equality. So I think it's very important to, we've talked about from reform to abolition, that's the title of our panel, right? The idea is to not think in terms of these small gains that might come along the way, but rather focus on the end point, right? That's when we'll be satisfied. That's the way I look at it.
I would add about we need to see the horizon. No? The Zapatistas, the himno Zapatista, ya se mira el horizonte. Uh-huh. I can see the horizon. And horizons help us to keep walking and not to lose the vision. No? So we need to look at the end and what we want. And not be restrained to borders and boundaries that sometimes we put to ourselves. You know, I think something that helped me personally, it was learning about my own history when I came to high school. I didn't know how to fit. I'm kind of white, right? And I liked classic rock when I was growing up in Mexico, and my friends were the banda music, and I was so confused, no? First, I had to learn about myself, my history, and then our human history, and then start thinking and not just read the books that they give us in schools. There's a lot out there.
All right, I see we have our next group of presenters with us. So thank you very much to our audience. We'll be around all day, so please come and find us, all right?